So congratulations to those of you who've managed to get here this morning with or without a hangover after yesterday evening's dinner. And what I'm going to be telling you about is a new specimen that we have in the museum that we've made the focus of a major new public exhibition. And it's been an interesting project for me. It's taken up something like 2 and 3 years of my life so far now. It's been very time consuming but very rewarding. And it's a project we've been trying to push forwards on several different fronts. So we've been pushing forwards on a new exhibit as an outreach item and as an item for helping get donor recognition within the museum, trying to encourage other people to give us money to do work at the museum, and also obviously for science. So whenever we acquire a new specimen at the museum now, we have a kind of tick list of things that every specimen has to achieve. And those tick list things are, it has to be some kind of collections enhancement, it has to improve our collection in some kind of way, it has to do outreach or some kind of development work, and it has to generate new science, otherwise we simply won't look into acquiring it in the first place. And obviously with SOPHIE, this is exactly what we managed to do. So it's an expert audience, so I don't really need to introduce Stegosaurus to you. But one of the things that even expert audiences don't realise is that Stegosaurus is a relatively poorly known dinosaur. It's a dinosaur that's only known from a handful of complete specimens. Of those complete specimens, only a couple have really been studied in any detail. In particular, the type specimen, which is in the of Stegosaurus stenops, which is in the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. And that specimen is relatively complete. It's missing some of the armour, it's missing some of the limb material. It has a beautifully complete skull, still preserved, completely articulated. But it's basically the only specimen on which we've based our entire knowledge of Stegosaurus now for over a century. And as a result, any other new material has really got some potential to tell us something about this animal. The other specimens that are currently available are even less complete in various different ways, or they are very difficult to study. They're effectively roadkill skeletons that have been squashed flat and very difficult to interpret. So SOPHIE offers an interesting perspective because not only is she very complete, but she's also three-dimensionally preserved, which means we can do things with SOPHIE's skeleton that weren't previously accessible. And just to give a plug for things in London and for Susie's benefit in the front row, because this is her favourite fossil, this is the earliest known stegosaur. This is Dasyatrurus, which was named in 1876 by Richard Owen. It graces the galleries of the NHM. So this is the best stegosaur skeleton that we had in the UK of any kind of stegosaur until we bought SOPHIE. So this is all that we had to work with. So getting SOPHIE into our collections was an amazing kind of boost to the sorts of comparative material we have in our collections, as well as having a dinosaur that has a lot of face recognition. It's really, really iconic. So what do we know about Stegosaurus so far? Well, it's named by this extremely genial-looking man back in 1877. So this is O.C. Marsh, and Marsh was given the first material of Stegosaurus that was coming out of the Morrison Formation. He only had fragmentary remains to start with, but enough for him to recognise that he had a new distinctive type of dinosaur. And on that basis, and then on the basis of numerous other remains that came to light over the next 10 years or so, he was able to attempt the first reconstruction of Stegosaurus, which looked something like this. Now, it's not too bad. I think most of you will agree with me that if you've ever seen a modern reconstruction of Stegosaurus, this isn't terrible. It's not like the Manteleguanodon reconstruction, for example. It's not like Owen's Iguanodon reconstruction. This is actually an animal that looks more or less the same. The proportions are a bit screwy, and there are a few other things wrong with it as well, which I'm sure a lot of you will spot. So, for some reason, Marsh pimped up the tail. He added more spikes than we need to have. This suggests some kind of insecurity to me in Marsh's personality. He kept adding spikes to the end of the tail. He also got the number of plates slightly wrong, the arrangement slightly wrong, but not too bad, given he didn't have a complete specimen to work with. The one thing that I think is most amusing, but it's often the most subtle thing, is if you look at the neck of Stegosaurus, it intrigues me to know how it reaches the ground to drink. So this is actually the first waterfall drinking adapted dinosaur of all time, because there's no way that head's going to reach the floor. But other than this, it's actually not too bad. In terms of things like looking at the structure of the hips, looking at the structure of the limbs and the tail, he actually did a pretty good job with fairly incomplete material. The next person to come along and look at Stegosaurus in any detail was Charles Whitby Gilmore at the Smithsonian, based on that new Smithsonian specimen that turned up after Marsh actually died and given up work on these animals some years previous to that as well. And he produced the monograph that is still the widely cited monograph that describes the anatomy of Stegosaurus. Now, of course, Stegosaurus has to be viewed in some kind of context. It's part of a really extensive ecosystem, the Morrison Formation ecosystem, so we're back in the late Jurassic, probably sometime in the Tithonian. Unfortunately, we don't have a precise date on the SOPHIE quarry. We've been unable to really pin down the exact age of the quarry, but we know it's from probably from the Tithonian, and it's this kind of formation that yields these kind of classic scenes. So animals like Allosaurus, Diplodocus, very well-known animals, a huge ecosystem of around 40 different animals, of which Stegosaurus is only one. But to re-emphasize the point I made earlier, Stegosaurus is really, really rare. So there are some estimates, for example, of numbers of Diplodocuses in museum collections, which range around 1,800 specimens, something like that, confidently identified as Diplodocus. Stegosaurus, we're only talking really about 7 or 8 really good skeletons that you can find. One in Smithsonian, one in Denver, SOPHIE, and several skeletons that Herbie has in his museum in Atoll in Europe. So there are really few of these animals around. And I like to give the analogy that if you're going on a safari today and you were looking for the kind of common animals, the Diplodocus were basically like elephants, they're fairly common, you see them on safari everywhere. But your Stegosaurus, they're in that ecosystem, but they're rare. It would be like spotting a rhino, or something like that. You know they're there, but you won't see them every day, or maybe not in the course of a short safari. So they're there, but they're bit part players in this ecosystem. And again, say you see these videos, Stegosaurus are actually rather rare dinosaurs in general. They're not around for very long. All of the tacks that we have actually know them from very poor material in general, except for a couple of more basic forms from China. So these are animals where any new information can really feed our picture of what's going on. So where did we get SOPHIE from? We initially found out about SOPHIE through a random visit to the Tucson Rock and Mineral Show back in 2012, where we saw a cast of skeleton on display. We went to congratulate the people displaying the cast on the nice cast, and then they revealed that the skeleton was actually available for sale. And it was at that point that the museum decided that this was something that we might like to get involved in for the reasons I said. Though obviously they said, this is a brilliant idea, we'd really love to see a new skeleton, now go and find the money and purchase it. So as it happened, we were really lucky in that we got a donor who appeared at the same time, wanting to help the museum out, who then gave a pot of money to the museum, not only to buy SOPHIE, but to redevelop the exhibits and to fund the postdoc to work with me for a year on the skeleton. Now, just a quick note on the ethics of buying and selling fossils, because obviously we had a whole symposium on this. This is probably the most famous fossil of all time, certainly the most expensive. This is Sue in the Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago. And fossils basically now have a commercial value. So to assure everybody here, SOPHIE was legally collected from privately owned land, sold legally to the people that excavated her and prepared her, and then the museum bought it in that way. And the museum condones the sale of old fossils as long as it's done legally and ethically. And we're happy to engage with people engaged in that trade. We're not so happy to do it with people who do it illegally, and very happy to forward their names to the appropriate authorities. But legal collectors and dealers, we're more than happy to work with. So SOPHIE comes to a place called just outside Shell in Wyoming. Shell is not a very big place, as you can see, and it also happens to be ranching cattle. So these are big cattle ranches in this area, where the specimen was found by a guy called Bob Simons, who was excavating a Diplodocus skeleton on Red Canyon Ranch, and happened by accident to come across the skeleton during that other excavation. Bob was unable to excavate it on his own. It was too big a project for the kind of material he was used to working with. He didn't have a big crew. But luckily for him, Kirby and his crew were just coming off an adjacent property, had nothing to do, and had lots of experience with excavating this type of material, and joined in Bob's effort and helped him get the skeleton out of the ground. And this is what the skeleton looked like in the ground. And you can already see here a lot of the skeleton is there. You can see from that first photograph that you're dealing with an extremely complete animal that's more or less in life position than found. So according to Kirby, who led this excavation, the skeleton's very poorly preserved, and they had to do a lot of work to conserve it as they got it out of the ground itself. And this is Kirby's field map of that excavation going back to 2003-2004, when the specimen was actually excavated. And it's just colour-coded by body region, and you can see there's a lot here, with the hind limbs in orange, the arm in green, vertebral column in blue, and skull bones in yellow. And you can see the skull bones are scattered, so the skull is mainly complete, but unlike the type skull in the Smithsonian, it's disarticulated, which means we can do a hell of a lot more with it. And when we reconstruct the skeleton, this is what it looks like. So this is again Kirby's reconstruction of what was present during the excavation. The only things that we don't have are in white. And actually, some of that material was originally present but accidentally damaged during the excavation when it wasn't realised there was a skeleton there, or had naturally eroded away before the excavation started. There are various ways you can calculate the completeness of the skeleton. It depends who you want to annoy and who you want to get one up on in order to calculate those kinds of things. But in terms of the amount of the body that's there, we have about 90% of the body present. We're really only missing one forelimb and a bit of the tail. If we do a bone-by-bone count, the amount goes down to about 65%, but that's largely because it lacks phalanges and it lacks humeral arches and things like that, which are completely useless from any paleobiological or taxonomic point of view. So luckily, the bits that are missing are totally uninformative. And this is what the material looks like. So this was laid out on the floor in a facility in Salt Lake City when I went to look at it for the first time and see the original. You can see the quality of the preservation in terms of morphology is actually very, very good. You can get a lot of detail out of this animal. And unlike those other specimens that are available, it's not a slab map. This is actually a three-dimensional object. So we can put it in a very nice pose. And this is how Sophie looks in the museum now. So you can get around Sophie in the round. The one thing that's absolutely terrifying to work on this specimen, and Susan will support me, is the plates. The plates are very, very pretty, but they're unbelievably thin. And you see those little kind of free bits around the edges of the plates, which are genuine things. They're kind of epiphenomenon of how the plate forms. Those things break very, very regularly, and we've actually got really good at learning how to repair them. So that's quite scary. So the main thing we had to do, obviously, was work out how to mount Sophie and put her on exhibition. So we did several trial excavations of mountings, basically so that we could work out how to do this in the public gallery when the time came without breaking it or dropping it or doing it in the most efficient way possible. So we got it down to about an hour and a half in the end. But when we mounted it for real in the museum gallery, which is a lot harder, a lot of other things in the way, a lot of things going on, it took about 4 hours. And our topping out ceremony was putting the last big plate in, which is the most frightening one to do. But anyway, that's more to do with where Sophie comes from and to do with the excavation. But what I want to go on to talk about is actually the science of Sophie and what we did. So we kept the purchase secret for a year, which was quite difficult. We had to get lots of people signing non-disclosure agreements, all sorts of things. I had my own government data scandal where I nearly lost a memory stick with lots of pictures and so forth in the public galleries and museums. But luckily I just dropped it in a box for the bursary at the end after 2 days of sweating about it. But I managed to assemble a very good team of people to help me work on this. So I had Susie, who you're going to see next, and Susie, obviously, as many of you know, is a world-leading expert on stegosaurs, and very conveniently, her institution is a 5-minute walk from mine. Charlotte was employed with me on this grant for a year to work on it, and Charlotte is an imaging whiz. She's mainly a biomechanicist, but she's also an excellent biological imaging person. And Stefan Altenschlager, who's at the University of Bristol, who's an excellent modelling person in terms of working on cranial dynamics. So the first kinds of things we wanted to do was to actually update that 100-year-old monograph by Gilmore. No one's described stegosaurs in any detail at all in that period. So the first thing to do is the bread and butter kind of stuff, and actually update the anatomy. And this is ongoing work, we still have the skull to do, or I know Susie's now looking at me disapprovingly, I still have the skull to do, and so that she can finish it off. But we have done the post-cranial anatomy. She's now published as a monograph in PLOS One, and that was fairly time-consuming in itself, but this is for the first time we have actually figured every bone of a stegosaur skeleton in every standard view, and given an update to Gilmore's work. The other thing we did was wanted to build some three-dimensional models, virtual models of the skeleton, so that we could really get into doing some biology of the specimen. Stegosaurus has suffered from not having very much paleobiological analysis over the years, and one way we did this was to build a photogrammetric model. Nice and cheap, not so quick, because there are lots of bones. It took Charlotte 3 months of building this model, and it took about 25,000 individual photographs went into making the 3D model we did of that bone. But using photogrammetry, we can get very good high-resolution, sub-millimeter accuracy just using a regular camera and a lot of free software that's available at some time. The other thing that we did, though, was we managed to get a movie company interested. And this movie company called PropShop was actually doing Guardians of the Galaxy and Star Wars movies at the time. And it was a contact that was completely random. They wrote to me and said, one of us is really keen on dinosaurs. We've made a 3D-printed dinosaur. We want some of the museum to tell us if it looks okay. So I went out to Pinewood and I got a tour, which was quite cool, but I didn't see anyone famous, unfortunately. And then it was pointed out that these kinds of sets, these days, are made entirely by 3D printing. Everything in that picture of Chris Pratt, except Chris Pratt, is 3D printed, literally everything. So they have these huge 3D printers, lots of laser scanning technology for making those 3D prints, which led us to think we could work with them. And luckily, because they have some diamond nodes on their staff, that's exactly what happened. They brought their scanners in. They're the sorts of scanners that the museum couldn't afford. They cost £250,000 in scanners. They're big enough to scan a car. So these things, they brought them in, spent 3 days scanning it. And also, that enabled us to do some 3D printing. So for outreach purposes and building models and things like that, we've got the files now to 3D print those particular things and use them in exhibitions and as handling objects. But this is the ultimate aim, getting a 3D virtual model of Sophie. And this is what it looks like. This is the model we published in that postcranial description that I mentioned just now. So what do you want to actually do with that kind of 3D model once we have it? Well, obviously, although we have a nice complete skeleton, the stegosaurus is a big animal, the individual bones themselves are actually pretty fragile. We don't want to throw them about too much, we can't move them about, manipulate them in very many ways. So we want to do lots of work in a virtual environment where we can do not only basic analyses, but sensitivity analyses of the kinds of questions that we're interested in. So the first question we were interested in that we had about was estimating Sophie's body mass and looking at different ways of estimating body mass and comparing different techniques. Now, many of you will know of traditional techniques for estimating body mass of extinct mammals and dinosaurs by using regression equations. Basically, you take lots of limb measurements, limb circumferences, you estimate body masses from those using relatively well-derived data sets that are based primarily on living mammals and some other animals. So that's one way of doing it. Another way that you can do, however, when you have a complete skeleton is a technique called convex hulling, where basically you take your complete skeleton and you wrap it in muscles and skin, and then you calculate the volume of that model, and then through relatively simple calculation based on average body density and so on, taking into account things like the airspace for lungs and all that kind of thing, you can then come up with a body mass estimate. So we wanted to compare that old technique of just taking limb circumferences and estimating masses, and then using this newer technique of actually building up a model of Sophie and effectively dunking her in a virtual Archimedes can and working out what her volume is. So interestingly, what we found when we first did this was there was absolutely no correspondence between the two methods, which we found really, really worrying to start with. We had a discrepancy of at least twice. I think the traditional methods gave us a discrepancy where Sophie weighed twice as much as our convex hull models. But then we realized that we were doing something wrong. And what we were doing wrong is we'd forgotten that Sophie is a juvenile. So work that was done on Sophie while she was still in Kirby's possession at Attar by Martin Sander and Ragnar Reglansdorf was that they looked at the age of Sophie, they did some histology on her limb bones, and they found out that Sophie was still growing when she died. She was about 8 years old, probably, when she died, and still growing quite fast. The problem with the limb bones, the confidence technique, the classic scaling technique, is that it relies on animals that are adult. Not juveniles. And as a result, this was the reason for the discrepancy. So we did some additional calculations on our data to account for the age difference with Sophie, and then the two techniques actually overlap quite well. So both of those techniques seem to actually give the same general answer. I would say ideally, you probably want to do the convex hulling, because it's actually based on a complete skeleton and a complete volumetric method. But the limb bone scaling is still a good technique because most skeletons aren't complete, but you might be lucky enough to have a femur or a humerus that you can use. And it does look like those two different techniques, when you take the age difference into account, seem to work quite well. The other thing that you can do with this kind of technique that you can't do with the traditional limb bone scaling is sensitivity analyses. Because there are obviously unknowns in this. We don't necessarily know exactly how big Sophie's muscles are. We don't necessarily know how much gut she has. So we have different models to look at the sensitivity of the models and the weights that we're obtaining from them by having basically an anorexic Sophie, a kind of Kate Moss Sophie, that basically looks like she's been shrink-wrapped, all the way up to having a Sophie that's a lot like me, with a lot of additional padding around the skeleton. So very large kind of bodied Sophie. And we went through those different variations and compared all those sensitivity measures with the traditional limb bone scaling method to come up with our guess for what Sophie weighed. When I was a kid, my mum always told me you never ask a lady her weight or her age. But this was the first thing we asked Sophie, because obviously now we know that age, we can look at potentially in the future things like growth rates, we can add that into other work that's being done with stegosaurus to look at growth rates. We can also think about things like dietary requirements. Now we have a body mass to work to, and they're very scaling equations we can use to look at things like food intake and so on. So this was the first thing we did, and Sophie, it turns out, weighed about 1.5 tons, which is about the same as a smallish rhino. So not a monster by any stage, and actually, as I said earlier, she is a juvenile. So about 5.5 metres in length, about 3 metres high over the hips, whereas a big stegosaurus gets up to about 9 metres in length and probably about 3 tonnes. So what is currently in progress with Sophie includes looking at her, also her biomechanics. So this is something that both Susie and Charlotte have past research interest in, looking at the relative contributions of the limb muscles to the walking cycle and their relative importance in actually working as either adductors, abductors, flexors or extensors and rotators, all those kinds of things. And we've been doing that by using that same virtual model, placing it in biomechanical software. This is software called Gateson, which was developed by a group of people at Manchester, where luckily Charlotte also did her PhD, so she knows this software inside out. And using this kind of software, we can actually model some of the different effects of those different muscles. So this is the kind of result you get. I would emphasize this is not a biologically realistic result. Stegosaurs do not normally face plant the floor in this kind of manner and go below the surface of the earth. Similarly, stegosaurs also probably weren't biomechanically capable of balancing on a ball and doing this. But by going through these ranges of motion, we can see what joint angles work, the advantages of those joint angles, eliminate possibilities and actually build this together with a lot of different muscles to look in total at how they're working and contributing to Sophie's walking cycle. And that's work that's in progress right now. Something that's always been debated about stegosaurus is what is the armour for? There's been a lot of debate over whether the plates are there for thermoregulation, display, armour, and various other different functions that you could describe as kind of sub-functions of those three. So, and also a difference between how the spikes are used and how the plates might be used. And Sophie's armour is actually pretty impressive. So she has a complete set of tail spikes, she has an effectively complete set of plates. So we can start to address some of these questions. And again, one of the things that's on the list of things to do, although we haven't got around to it yet, is we've done the primary data collection, is actually using these kinds of CT scans to do some finite element modelling on these elements to see really how strong they were, the effects of putting keratin over them in terms of strengthening the plates. So again, we can do some sensitivity analyses on what's going on here. We have the internal structure of these things now coming through from these CT scans as well. And we have this partly for the plates and also partly for the spikes. We're also sharing this data with various other colleagues around the world. So for example, we've been sharing the plate information with Jim Farlow in the US, who's been doing some interesting work there with some of his students on what the plate function might be also. So a nice communal effort there. And we've also been using traditional CT scanning to look at these plates in other ways, basically to get three-dimensional models that complement those from the photogrammetry. Actually, the plates themselves were almost impossible to either photogrammetry or laser scan because they're so thin and very difficult to crop. So we're relying more on some of the CT scans from that. But where it's becoming particularly important is actually for the skull, and this is part of the skull of Sophie, as we originally collected it from Kirby when we acquired the specimen. And this is just one of the boxes. The skull is 90% complete, more or less. There are a lot of the elements there. They're completely disarticulated. It's an unprecedented opportunity to look inside the head of a stegosaurus. The one in the Smithsonian has a beautiful complete skull, but it's fully articulated. You can't do very much with it. It's not been CT scanned yet, or at least if it has, it's not, the data's not been released. It might still be lurking on someone's hard drive in Ohio, for example. I suspect it's not got out of there yet. So, but this is a really nice opportunity to do something with the skull from first principles. So Charlotte spent an awful lot of time staring at CT scans and getting to know the anatomy of these things. It's also very useful from a basic anatomy point of view because obviously a few of the bones are restored or they've been reinforced in various ways to help with their preservation. And this gives us the exact information we need when we're doing that detailed description again. We'll get this to work. Other things we're doing, obviously, with these kinds of CT scans, other than looking at the basic anatomy, we're also working on an endocross. And you'll be interested to know, obviously, everyone knows that stegosaurus is the brain size of a walnut. Actually, it's not. We made a stunning revelation with Sophie. It's not the size of a walnut, it's closer to two walnuts. Or a satsuma. I was hoping it would be some very exotic fruit, like a kiwi fruit or something like that. But satsuma is the best we can do. But using those CT scans, we go to Stefan, who has a number of interesting algorithms for retroreforming elements, putting them back into their original life position after they've been deformed. And this is our composite reconstruction of Sophie's skull based on the actual skull bones themselves. And you can see almost all the skull is there. There's a little bit of unknown at the back end of the palate. We don't have a complete jugal, but there are one or two bits just at the back of the skull, and we can augment that with information from the Smithsonian skull to complete our model of the skull. So we've been using the skull in a paper that's just been published to look at the finite element analysis of the skull. So in this we compared it with a number of different dinosaur herbivores, and Sophie is on this line in the middle, this Plateosaurus at the top, and this Alichosaurus, the Therizinosaur, at the bottom. And we're looking at basically comparing these different relatively what we call unspecialized herbivores. These are animals that don't have a grinding dentition, they don't have a cranial kinesis, they don't have anything much going for them in terms of mastication at all. And we wanted to see how different or similar they are. And so you can see these various different models with cool colours basically representing areas of low stress in the skull, the hot colours representing areas of high stress. And you can actually just see at a glance, these are different bite scenarios with bites at the front of the skull, at the midpoint of the tooth row, and the back of the tooth row. You can see that these three attacks actually differ in a number of key ways. One of the big surprises from this work is that Stegosaurus has a very high bite force for a herbivore, which was a complete surprise. I was expecting it to be totally pathetic, because everything else about the jaws of this animal are totally pathetic in comparison with other herbivores. Teeth at the size of my little fingernail or less. So these things actually end up with a bite that's not that far off from that of a sheep or a cow. And that sounds fantastically underwhelming, unless you work on herbivores and you realise that sheep and cows actually bite really hard for herbivores. They're not T-Rexes, thankfully. So these things are actually doing something really special with their skulls, and it opens up a huge amount of other ecological things they could be doing. Eating maybe quite tough vegetation, at least being able to bite it off. Whereas before, these things were basically thought to be pulpy mush. And at the same time, interestingly, we found some of the really interesting stuff about these animals. It looks like Alichosaurus, for example, is specialised for using just the front of its skull to nip vegetation. It's a very weak skull in lots of different ways, really weak. So if the crown of the pathetic dinosaur herbivore now goes to a theropod, I'm glad to say. Whereas up here, Plateosaurus is actually a more generalist animal with a skull that's actually very well engineered, and it looks like, again, that bone, I like this in particular because it goes along with my idea I had a number of years ago that these were fairly generalist feeders that could maybe take prey from time to time as well as eating food, plant food. So one of the main messages from that work though for us has been these animals actually look fairly similar. They all have long snouts, the snouts are all narrow, the jaws all work awfully without any rotation or any kind of kinesis. They have huge cranial openings. They're superficially fairly similar, although they come from very distinct evolutionary lineages. But what our work found is that despite that convergence in how these animals seem to build their skulls, they actually function in really different ways. And again, this was a surprise to me. I'm a classic form function person from when I did my PhD 20 years ago. He asked me 20 years ago, and said those three animals were doing exactly the same kind of thing. They're basically using their jaws like scissors, probably not doing very much, and probably working in very similar ways. But when we look at the patterns of force around the skull, despite the fact that they have these gross similarities, it does look like they're doing something different. So this is an ongoing story. We still have other things to do on the skull. The postcranial skeleton was published. We've now done our study on the feeding of the skull. We're also doing some other work on weight. We've now got in progress this work that we are, there's a manuscript actually to see on what we're doing with the limb mechanics. But we still have to go on to do work on the skull, and we have one or two projects lined up with our finite element stuff and plate. So there's another, at least another couple of years in this project, which is something I wasn't expecting to do, and suddenly just came along out of the blue thanks to a large check and seeing a model at our show. So, thank you very much.